In just a few moments, you're going to hear from our new interim chancellor, the chair of your faculty senate, and from our featured faculty presenter. We will recognize and celebrate the achievements and service of many of our distinguished faculty colleagues, and at the end of it all, we get to catch up and connect with each other at the reception. At this time, I'd love to recognize and thank my wonderful Blair School of Music colleague, Jennifer McGuire, for the lovely prelude music she provided us. Thank you. And now, to kick things off in a wonderful, stirring fashion, Jennifer will be joined by Associate Professor of Voice Tyler Nelson for what promises to be an exquisite rendition of Dein ist mein ganzes Herz, one of Franz Lehár's most famous arias from his operetta Das Land des Lächelns. Please welcome Jennifer McGuire and Tyler Nelson. And for the daily blow to Jeremy's ego, even though I spent 5 years living in a German-speaking country, it's always nice to remind myself that the entire voice department at the Blair School has better German diction than I do. So thank you all so much for that wonderful performance. At this time, I want to take a moment to thank some people for helping make this assembly a reality. A huge thank you to everyone involved in the Faculty Senate, and especially our wonderful Debbie Hayes. Please help me thank her. Also, thank you to the Office of Faculty Affairs, the Chancellor's Office, the Division of Communications, and of course, the wonderful Vanderbilt Events staff and Student Life Center staff. We, the faculty, are so grateful to all of you. Thank you very much. It's now my pleasure to welcome to the podium Interim Chancellor Susan Wente.
Wow, welcome. Thank you all so much for coming today. And I really am excited about everything we have to look forward to in the upcoming year. I want to thank you, Jeremy, for your leadership here in terms of helping MC this program. And I also want to thank our new leaders of the Faculty Senate, John McClain and Holly Allgood, for everything they're going to do in the next year for all of you. I really appreciate your coming. It's really an honor for me to be able to serve the university in this interim chancellor and provost role. And yes, Chancellor Emeritus Nicholas Zepos will be sorely missed, but I want to remind all of you that he's not leaving us. Indeed, actually, I think as he was packing up his office last Thursday, I heard him murmuring about doing campaign planning to run for the Faculty Senate next year. So, you, who knows? All kidding aside, my overall message today is simple. Oh, wait a minute. I got to write down 417. There's some bets going on in the audience in terms of where I'm going to come in at. So my message is very simple. One, he built a strong foundation, an incredibly strong foundation, and we are on a strong path forward. And we're going to move forward together, guided by our mission and our values, front and center. My goal as interim chancellor and provost is to ensure that we are continuing to invest in the faculty and in the student experience. The faculty, you've heard it before, and it is true, you are the lifeblood of the university. Your work, your service, your teaching, your discoveries, they are what have formed this strong foundation. Creativity has helped form this strong foundation, just like the creativity that we just heard from Professors Nelson and McGuire. Thank you again for that beautiful performance. It's simple to say, but it's true. It's our people that make us great. And as we start the new year, as we sit here thinking about all the students who have flooded back on campus, I've often asked many that I work with the simple question of why. Why are we here? Or why do we do what we do? Some people have asked me, why in the world would you take on the job of both interim chancellor and provost? Well, it isn't just because the board asked me to. It is because we have such incredibly strong leadership across this university, from department chairs, to deans, to the vice provost, to the vice chancellors, that I know I'm not going to be doing this alone. Each one of you here in this room, as a faculty member, you are a leader here with us. The students look to you as leaders who are embracing our mission and our values. And so that means we will go forth, as I've said many, many times, together. But in addition to that, and in addition to the fact that I feel we're able to move forward together on this strong foundation, I'm also doing this because of my passion for our mission. Like all of you, I am devoted to ensuring that Vanderbilt offers excellence in its education and teaching, its scholarship and its creative expression. I, just like all of you, am committed to the value of a broad-based liberal education embedded in the heart of a research environment, and that together we're helping solve humanity's greatest challenges. And that we're doing this while engaging in a living learning environment, a living learning community, where an elite education is achievable and focuses on the whole student. And at that same time, that we are committed to fostering a diverse and inclusive community that's strengthened by a diversity of perspectives, every person's perspective, such that every person in our community has a role in our One Vanderbilt. Collectively, I am confident that we are going to continue having an impact. So how do we accomplish our why? How do we accomplish our mission? Well, one, we must continue learning from one another and broadly learning across the campus. But more so, as I've been articulating in some of my messages and will continue to articulate, there are three guiding principles that I'm going to really be focusing on as Interim Chancellor and Provost, and those are trust, transparency, and teamwork. And in such a large, complex university like we are, with such a diversity of perspectives, each of these three principles require continual effort, continual focus, and reinforcement. We all have to be partners in each one of these. So let's talk first just a little bit about trust. Clearly, there must be collective trust at every level and across levels, if you want to think horizontally and laterally. Trust that we hold one another accountable, and that trust that we are going to invest in success, and that we will make decisions based upon evidence. That being my little scientist, you know, part there, data, evidence. And that we have to continually support this trust. So that is that key communication message. And I'm committed to continuing to communicate with you in good times or in bad. I'm the optimist, so there's going to be a lot of good times. But regardless, we've got to communicate to help build relationships. It's these relationships that are so essential. Relationships are so essential because when we have the chance to seize an opportunity or when we're facing a challenge, if those relationships are in place, then we trust each other enough to know each other enough that we will be able to find solutions going together. If we have that trust, we will be successful. Now, a key part of trust is transparency, and transparency is a really, really difficult term. Transparency doesn't mean that myself or any someone in leadership is going to necessarily be able to share all the information all the time. There are constraints on that are put in place for a variety of reasons that help support and protect each one of us who are here. But more importantly, in terms of transparency, I am committed and have been committed as provost and now as interim chancellor to share the principles that are driving our decisions. How do we decide what to do? What are we deciding to do? What are the processes? What are the approaches that we take? So that you know what is happening and why, but you also know how you can get involved. Because part of transparency is having an open process by which everyone can have a voice. As we know, everything's not perfect. I'll be the first one to admit that. We have work to do, but we have ways in which we can discuss and analyze as a community, ways in which we can know what choices are possible and what's guiding any actions, and again, to share the evidence upon which decisions are being made. Now, finally, in addition to trust and transparency, a really key part of our secret sauce that pulls that all together is teamwork. I'm big on teamwork. A large part of that comes from starting as running a research lab. If you didn't build a team, you were never going to get an experiment done. We have to pride ourselves in terms of our ability to build teams. And Vanderbilt often talks about our collegial, our collaborative, our civil environment. And you're going to hear a lot about that from the Faculty Senate this year in terms of their themes. This teamwork is also driven by shared governance, and we've done a lot over the last 5 years working together to really strengthen our shared governance across Vanderbilt, where faculty can reach across disciplines, reach across schools to jointly teach and to jointly engage and to jointly offer one another their help and their expertise. A key part of teamwork is this one word, cooperation. Cooperation to me means is a little bit different than collaboration. Cooperation means to me that you're willing to help someone even if there's nothing in it for you. And that's something that I think is a really important part of what we do at Vanderbilt in terms of our teamwork. Again, it doesn't happen on its own. We have to nurture teamwork. We have to inspire teamwork. We have to reward teamwork. And we also know that it's through diverse and inclusive teams that we will have the opportunity or even the chance to be the most successful. We value teams that bring together diverse perspectives, that bring together different learned experiences, because that's when we can be innovative. That's when we can be creative. That's when we can really make a difference here on this campus and also as we take our work further out into the world. So I think these three guiding principles are essential ingredients of our shared governance, and all three are key to our success. And I hope that you'll work with me to make trust, transparency, and teamwork even stronger here at Vanderbilt. Now, teamwork was definitely part of the process that launched the academic strategic plan. We came together to craft that now and launch it 5 years ago. And during the planning process, there were over 1,500 Vanderbilt faculty, students, and staff who gave input and worked to really bring that document about. But even more so, people have been very involved over the last 5 years in terms of implementing those actions. So there's been progress in many different aspects of the academic strategic plan across all four of those original pillars. That progress in the plan also lets us now position ourselves to take advantage of strategic opportunities as they come up. The plan wasn't meant to be a finished document. It was meant to be a blueprint for the future that had flexibility. And we've really leveraged that over the past 5 years to take on, if you want to call, mini strategic planning processes around specialized topics. And some of them are listed on this slide. All of those have been launched through faculty-driven committees, and many different recommendations and actions have come forth, not just from the plan, but from all the different work over all of those years. And for anybody who's participated, both in that academic strategic planning process, but also in all of the work over these last 5 years in terms of the other committees and the additional implementation, I really want to thank you, because it's through your work, your voice, and your ideas that we're able to bring all of this to life and to actually see outcomes from it. So what are some examples of progress over the last 5 years? And we would be here for another hour if I tried to tell you all the progress, so I'm not going to. And this slide has a lot of information on it because I just kept trying to add things to it and make the font size smaller. You know how that works, right? So you can go to the website on the Academic Strategic Plan. You can look at the reports that issue in detail progress. And what two things I wanted to emphasize is that we now have more funding mechanisms and more different ways to try to invest in the faculty and to support research really at disciplinary intersections, but also all different kinds of scholarship and creative expression. The TIPS program, of course, has been a real mainstay and a hallmark and a great contributor to cross-college collaborations. If you remember, there was a commitment at that time from Provost McCarty, Vice Chancellor for Health Affairs Jeff Balzer, and Chancellor Nick Zeppos for $50 million over 5 years. In the last 5 years, the very rigorous, faculty-driven peer review process has awarded $38 million of that 50. So we're having a sixth call this fall. And then this spring, I hope we will all be able to come together to really focus on what do we want to do next. We're continuing to build a $300 million endowment in graduate education and research, which has the Russell G. Hamilton Scholars and the Leadership Institute launching from it. And even at the same time, while we're investing, this is attracting new partnerships from either donors or foundations or the government or industry to come here and help make investments in Vanderbilt faculty projects as well. So now, how do we ensure that this progress continues? So as I've said, we must invest in the faculty. And as provost, I made investing in the faculty a priority. For example, right now we're in the midst of our very first cohort of Public Voices Fellows. We've had five cohorts of Chancellor's Faculty Fellows, and we're working to increase the number of Dean's Faculty Fellows. We have created hundreds of new endowed chairs that have helped us recruit and retain exceptional faculty. I now plan to take this support for the faculty to the next level to really ensure that we can pursue excellence continually. And we're going to need your feedback to keep doing this. So for those of you who were here 4 years ago, this coming spring, you'll remember we did the coach survey. And we launched that coach survey to assess faculty satisfaction, and then a faculty working group analyzed the results, and we had multiple different school-based, college-based, and provost-based action items to follow up on all the feedback that you gave. In the next month, we'll post the next follow-up report on the status of those actions, but more importantly, in the spring of 2020, we will partner with the Faculty Senate to launch the next coach survey. So, reassessment. Always checking on how we're doing. Now, we also need to provide professional development to our faculty, development resources for them at all ranks, in all tracks, whether tenure track, research track, practice track, lecturer track, and especially for our early and mid-career faculty. I'm grateful to all the leadership in the schools and colleges for their efforts in terms of developing these new faculty development strategies, and also to the new leaders on this slide who are serving at the university level to help develop new strategies for faculty development. And I'm really pleased today to announce that I'm going to launch a new Interim Chancellor's Diversity Council that William Robinson and Andre Churchwell will co-chair. This advisory body is going to focus on guiding our efforts for further strengthening and supporting our inclusive community. Specifically for women on campus, you know that we have two committees who started working last year and are continuing their work and continuing their work throughout this next semester and years to come. I'm also proud to say that Vanderbilt is a founding member of the National Academies Action Collaborative to combat sexual harassment in higher education, and that we're also partnering across the community to celebrate the 100th anniversary of the ratification of the 19th Amendment and Nashville's key role in that moment. So we've got a lot going on, and there's more to do. And although we're in a time of transition right now, or we might feel like we're in a time of transition, nothing's slowing down. As you may have heard me say, or you may have read that I've said, there's no pause button. We're going to continue building on the strong foundation by being innovative to ensure that our faculty, students, and our staff have the opportunity to achieve their full potential. And to do this, I believe that trust goes hand in hand with resources and with strategy. So what are some of the new things that we're doing? Well, one new initiative that we're going to push hard on this next year through the partnership with the faculty's directions and efforts is the new Global VU initiative. This grew out of the International Strategy Working Group and is now a TIPS initiative led by Ingrid Wirth and Ted Fisher. We have the building blocks to really take ourselves to the next level in terms of international recognition. We just need to engage more and be entrepreneurial in our approach. We have some tactics that are already launching, new funding programs, workshops, a new Global Fellows program that will leverage a new 20-story tower that's being built on West End Avenue. When you're driving down it in the morning, if you happen to, and you have to stop for the cement pouring, that's for that 20-story tower. So you know it's gonna keep going on for a while, because I think it's at about floor 6 right now, or 7? Oh, we're up to 9, okay. So that tower was designed with faculty feedback in mind, and it's going to allow us to host visiting scholars and thought leaders from around the country, from around the world, for collaboration and connection. This year, we've also will be launching a number of efforts converging together to expand our focus on society's original and continual forms of connection, the arts and the humanities. The arts and humanities are absolutely essential for our leadership in discovery and learning. And I'm excited to announce also that this fall, I'll be launching a University Arts Council, in part a complement to our University Research Council, but more so to be an advocate for all arts at Vanderbilt, and to also help us reach into our really creative Nashville community to help support that. So again, stay tuned for more details. The new council's work will be complemented by the new microgrant program that we launched last year, and a new online arts and humanities portal that just went live. So further, at a time when some universities are cutting resources for their university presses, I won't list and tell you who they are. We are investing with the recruitment of a new university press director and revamped, modernized approaches. And you may also have noticed and read that we've just launched a national search for Dean Mark Waite's successor. After 27 years of service, Dean Waite will retire from the deanship at the end of the academic year. And he's here. We're really looking forward, Mark, to celebrating with you all of this year. I also heard from you that we need to invest in data science and digital resources across all disciplines, across all schools and colleges. I don't think any place that you could go on campus there isn't someone who is thinking about how this impacts the work that they're doing in the classroom or in their scholarship and research. Of course, we launched the Data Science Institute last fall, being co-led by Andreas Berlin and Doug Schmidt. And just this week, they welcomed their first class of new data science master's students. Through TIPS, we've got seed funding allocated to advance a computational thinking and learning initiative. In conjunction, we have committees working on new digital resources and services, areas that are needed for investment. And also, we'll be doing this in coordination with an assessment of the library's resources and strategy. And then a new online education committee, which is going to make recommendations about what do the schools and colleges need to really make their online efforts even more successful. So now turning on campus and thinking about some aspects on campus in terms of our educational strategies and how we're aiming to educate the whole student, we're committed to designing programming, curriculum, and physical spaces that nurture opportunities for students, faculty, and staff to learn and discover together. These leaders on this slide have taken on new roles or taken steps up to focus on making sure that faculty and students are successful and that experiential learning is a value add for faculty and students. Yes, of course, when a faculty member engages with a student in an experiential project or a research project or any type of immersion project, that student's going to develop new skills by working very closely with the faculty member. But the faculty, I would argue, is also going to be able to move their research forward due to the involvement of the undergraduates. I see this myself with the neuroscience undergraduates who have for a long time worked in my laboratory and provided impetus and your curiosity that embeds and infuses itself amongst everybody there. So to be truly successful in terms of nurturing and sustaining living learning communities, it requires that we have residential spaces that support our programming and curriculum. So that's why we're working so hard on building out the residential college system for undergraduates. How many watched The Implosion? Yeah. If you haven't, it's a short video clip, but it was powerful. It was very, very powerful. And some could say, you know, that was out with the old, with that tower, that for how long did we hear, you know, bring them down? But it's in with the new in terms of that whole new complex that will be built along West End Row. These residential colleges are paid for through a combination of philanthropy and the provost dean of students' housing budget and with debt services needed. Now, I also hope you've heard that we're beginning to work on the first phase of a new graduate and professional student village. And it's going to be located on Broadway Avenue between Lyle and 20th Avenues. And this is possible. It'll break ground. The plan is to have it open, the first 600 beds, in the fall of 2021 through a public-private partnership with Lendlease, which is a premier graduate student housing developer. So this is very exciting. We haven't had graduate and professional student housing for, I could almost say, decades. So every school and college is also evaluating, making plans, and moving forward with much-needed capital improvements, inspired by their individual missions, the academic strategic plan, and Future VU. This Future VU, again, is something which has come to fruition over the last 5 years through Vice Chancellor Eric Kopstein's leadership. As part of Future VU, we also have a new sustainability plan that launched this spring with the goal of being carbon neutral and powering our campus entirely by renewable energy by 2050. Our students, and I know many of our faculty, are really excited about that. And then there's the Move VU initiative. We use VU in everything now, I think. But it's focused on improving transportation, mobility, accessibility, and potentially a campus greenway for further connectivity and walkability. So these projects, which are up on this slide, again, are based upon the priorities of each individual school and college and the faculty's priorities in research and education. The planning's driven by the deans, organized at the school and college level, and the funding for this project is not one size fits all. It depends upon a combination of philanthropy, the individual school's cash reserves. For certain projects, we may use debt or investments from the chancellor and the provost. But the common denominator between these buildings is that they're creating environments and conditions where excellence can emerge and be sustained for decades to come, where all of you can thrive. One highlight, which is on this next slide, is that we're beginning renovations on a building at 1101 19th Avenue that we acquired in our real estate portfolio. And it's going to bring together many of the priorities that I've talked about today in one space. A new digital commons, a new home for the Center for Digital Humanities, a new home for the Faculty Senate, yes, Debbie, and a new faculty commons for faculty development and other gatherings. There isn't a room there big enough to hold this number of people, but there are some really beautiful spaces that you can consider for faculty dinners, retreats, and other types of events. So we plan to have that open by the fall of 2020. Now, I would argue that Vanderbilt is, by all measures, in the strongest place it's been at any moment in its 146 years. And I want to provide you just a couple little quick snippets of what's the evidence for this strength. How can I make that assertion that we're at, you know, the strongest place we've been in the last 146 years? One, we've taken our place amongst the most highly regarded universities in the nation, whether it's innovation, financial aid, student quality of life. Your work is being widely recognized, and it's having a real impact. And our student athletes are winning national championships. Yay, baseball, go Coach Corbin. That was also a really made for a very exciting summer. And they're excelling in the classroom. So another piece of evidence is our financial strength and our financial position. This past year, we had our best year ever for annual giving and the highest amount ever of new gift money raised and documented bequests. Industry-sponsored research nearly doubled, and research awards are up. The university's endowment has grown by 10% on an annualized basis over the past 3 years. That's one of the highest growth rates among U.S. universities. And we continue to have the lowest debt burden compared to our private university peers. So our very strong financial position provides the fuel, it provides the confidence, it provides the trust for us to be able to take all of these bold actions. Another evidence of strength. We are recruiting the most accomplished and qualified students we have ever admitted to Vanderbilt. Through Opportunity Vanderbilt and the residential colleges, the class of 2023 represented several all-time highs, from admissions rates to the number of Pell-eligible students enrolled. Why do these students come here? They come here because of you. They come here because of our faculty. They want to take your courses. They want to engage with you. They want to learn at Vanderbilt. Now, when you zoom out and look at the student body as a whole, it's changed dramatically over time. I'm going to ask each of the faculty who are here earning their 25-year chair just how much it's changed over the last 25 years. A lot? They're all nodding. If you can't see them, they're nodding. Yes, it's changed a lot in 25 years. It'll probably change a lot in the next 25 years, too. But where we're at right now, our student body's transformation requires us to continually innovate. Have we adapted our teaching, our systems, our structures to allow our students to thrive? Are we addressing the touchstones of equity, diversity, and inclusion as fully and as earnestly as possible, not only amongst our students, but amongst our faculty and staff also? So the answers to these questions might not be a resounding yes just yet, but I'm committed working with you to continuing to strengthen our scholarship, our teaching, and our inclusive environment. One more further piece of evidence of our strength is that we are also willing to change, to make things better and to provide better support for our people and services. Just this week, we announced the launch of a new department, Human Capital and Business Services, and it's designed to bring new innovative thinking and approaches to finding and retaining the best staff possible. And finally, I have to put this, you knew I'd play this last Trump card, right? In terms of, well, I shouldn't say that. Play this last winning card. The true evidence of our strength is in who we are recruiting as faculty. Across the provost reporting areas, this was the new faculty orientation, 101 new faculty. VUMC welcomed over 200 new faculty since our last assembly. That's over 300 new colleagues across this beautiful university. Recruiting these faculty are just the first step. As I said before, we're committed to making a great faculty by investing across the entire career path. So let me end on these three guiding principles again. They bring us closer, they strengthen our mission, they enhance the clarity regarding the ideas that are driving us forward, and they will strengthen the foundation even further on which our momentum can persist. This is true whether we're overcoming obstacles or we're celebrating. Through these, I think we can create the conditions where excellence will be continually supported. And through it all, whatever comes our way, thunderstorm, I can hear it out there, whatever it happens to be, I am committed to continuing to listen, continuing to learn, and to be an advocate for you, for our students, for our staff, and for our great university. So it's my honor to be doing this tremendous work with you together, and I want to thank you for listening to me today. And I think I did pretty good on time. Thank you. And now it's time to recognize several special groups of colleagues who are here today. And I'm going to begin with the faculty who are celebrating 25 years with the university. When I read this list of names, I couldn't believe that some of them have been here for 25 years. Now, I truly regret that I cannot read their bios, because then we would be here for many more hours, because these are really, truly accomplished faculty members. There's more information on all of those that we're honoring today on the Office of the Provost Faculty Affairs website. And we'll also be sharing their milestone accomplishment in tomorrow's MyVU. So each of these faculty members, when I call your name, please come to the front area of the stage, and we'll gather there for a group photo. And I must ask the audience to hold your applause or your, bravos until I've recognized all of the faculty members. So we'll start with Stephen Gary Buckles, Philip David Charles, Amy S. Chomsky, Cynthia S. Cyrus, who I think is climbing a mountain somewhere on sabbatical, small sidebar, Thomas P. Doyle, Robin P. Fountain, Gina Frieden, Raymond A. Friedman, C. Galen Garrett, Joseph Hiante, Jonathan M. Gillian, Dario A. Gise, Nunzia B. Gise, Michael Goldfarb, Len E. Goodman, Senta Victoria Green, Michael S. Higgins, Leslie W. Hopkins, Shan Hong, Karen M. Yose, Amy Jill Levine, Letha Matthews, Ralph N. McKenzie, David M. Miller, Randolph A. Miller, Socrates T. Pantelis, Ray L. Pascal, Nimesh P. Patel, Jennifer A. Peetenpaul, Yu Shear, Mark A. Wallager, Mary I. Yarborough. Thank all of you for your 25 years of absolutely amazing, amazing service. And your 25 years of commitment. And now we'll see if we know how to line up for a photo. Next, we're going to recognize and celebrate colleagues who've discovered and created especially impactful research, scholarship, and creative expression works, or that they've contributed to the university through their exemplary service. So, John McLean, will you please join me on the stage to help me present these awards? So today we're going to make presentations in four different award categories. Awards honoring research, scholarship, or creative works include the Chancellor's Awards for Research, the Chancellor's Awards for Equity, Diversity, for Research in Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion, and the Earl Sutherland Prize for Achievement in Research. Nominations for those three categories of awards are considered by the Faculty Research Awards Review Committee, which has representation from across campus. For distinguished service, we are going to award the Thomas Jefferson Prize, and this awardee is chosen by the Faculty Senate Consultative Committee. Each award includes a cash prize and an engraved pewter julep cup or an engraved goblet. Now, as the names are announced for each award, I'm going to ask those awardees to please rise and come join John and me on stage while I continue with my remarks as you're making your way up. So as noted, we're going to begin with the Chancellor's Awards for Research. And these recognize excellence in research, scholarship, or creative expression in works that have been published or presented in the preceding three calendar years. And first, I want to recognize, and this is becoming a key tradition of our assemblies, I want to recognize the past recipients of the Chancellor's Award for Research. And this slide notes those who are planning to join us today. And will you all please stand if you're here so that we can recognize you for your prior awards and achievements. Keep making discoveries. And this year we're going to present five new Chancellor Awards for Research. The first goes to Sarah Igo, Professor of History. For her book, The Known Citizen, A History of Privacy in Modern America. The book traces why and how privacy came to matter to Americans from the Victorian era to the present day, raising pressing questions about how approaches to privacy have shaped our history, individual rights, and modern society. The Known Citizen has garnered recognition from the Washington Post and the New Yorker, among other publications, and also received this year's Meryl Curti Intellectual History Award from the Organization of American Historians. Congratulations, Sarah. The next Chancellor's Research Award goes to Mark Yarman, Centennial Professor of English, for his collection of verse, The Harunri Poems. Marking his 11th book of poetry, The Harunri contemplates themes of spirituality, faith, and doubt through Mark's formerly rigorous and distinctive verse. Published by the prestigious Sarah Band Press, the collection has garnered critical acclaim in the Hudson Review and Publishers Weekly, among other key library outlets, and received a starred review in Booklist. Congratulations, Mark. Chancellor's Research Award actually goes to three leaders. We recognize teamwork. They are a collaborative team for a co-authored work, Balanced Crystalloids versus Saline in Non-Critically Ill Patients. Todd Rice, Associate Professor of Medicine, Wesley Self, Associate Professor of Emergency Medicine, and Matthew Semler, Assistant Professor of Medicine, all collaborated with a team and led that team. Their studies examined the inner workings and effectiveness of crystalloids in common medical therapies. Published in the New England Journal of Medicine, the work has made a significant impact on clinical trials and physicians' practices and garnered important media attention among the medical community and the general public. Congratulations, Todd, Wesley, and Matthew. Chancellor Research Award goes to Sharon Weiss, Cornelius Vanderbilt Chair of Electrical Engineering. For her work entitled Experimental Realization of Deep Subwavelength Confinement in Dielectrical Optical Resonators, which was published in Science Advances. Sharon's research on the spatial confinement of light marks an enormous leap forward in the interplay of optics and electronics. She's received widespread acclaim from both the technical media outlets and the mainstream media for her groundbreaking discoveries. Congratulations, Sharon. And finally, our final Chancellor's Award for Research goes to Kimberly Welch, Assistant Professor of History and Assistant Professor of Law. I don't know if Kimberly is not here, but we will honor her. We will keep her check safe and her engraved cup safe. Her book, Black Litigants in the Antebellum American South, explores the legal dynamics of slave culture in the American South. Kim's book has shed new light on themes of race, rights, and civil inclusion in America. Her book has already won three major prizes, including the Bessard Best First Book Prize from the Society for Historians of the Early American Republic. We will congratulate you when we see you on campus, Kim. So next, I'm very pleased to present two awards in the category of Chancellor's Awards for Research in Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion. This is the third year that we've made this award, and it recognizes excellence in research, scholarship, or creative expression with works presented or published in the last three calendar years that specifically advance our understanding of equity, diversity, and inclusion. And are there any past recipients of the Chancellor's Awards for Research in Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion in the room? Please stand so we can recognize you. Thank you. The first award goes to Amy Hamray, Assistant Professor of Medicine, Health, and Society. For their book, Building Access, Universal Design, and the Politics of Disability, the work explores how science, technology, and architecture have converged as approaches began to shift towards inclusion. Critically, Amy's book also looks into how these practices have impacted racial segregation, disability law, citizenship, and other pressing themes. Congratulations, Amy. Our second Chancellor's Award for Research in Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion goes to Nicole Joseph, Assistant Professor for Mathematics Education. I don't see Nicole, but we will be sure also to get her prize to her. She is being recognized for her article, Black Girls and Women's Persistence in the P-20 Mathematics Pipeline, Two Decades of Children, Youth, and Adult Education Research. Through the lens of critical race theory and black feminism, Nicole's piece explores persistence of black women and girls in the field of mathematics and their consequent impact in shaping new paradigms, policy, and pathways for success. Co-authored with two of Nicole's graduate students, the article is published in the Review of Research and Education and has received significant critical attention. Looking forward to seeing her on campus too. So our next award is the annual Thomas Jefferson Prize for Distinguished Service to the University. Selected by the Faculty Senate Consultative Committee, this prize winner is an individual who's shown distinguished service to Vanderbilt through extraordinary contributions as a member of the faculty in the councils and the governments of the university. Again, we have some past recipients of the Thomas Jefferson Prize with us today. So would you please stand so that we can recognize you? This year's recipient of the Jefferson Prize is Timothy McNamara, Professor of Psychology in the College of Arts and Science. Given his academic leadership as a department chair for over two decades, and you know, many people have heard me say that being department chair is one of the toughest jobs on campus. In his roles as Associate Provost and Vice Provost, Tim has epitomized the service, leadership, and community engagement that we value as a university community and that define this award. He's been at the forefront of a variety of initiatives, including the growth of the psychology department, the expanded scope of the Office of Faculty Affairs and Vanderbilt's International Engagement, and he also, at one point in time, co-chaired an ANS Dean Search Committee and headed up planning for Vanderbilt's Sachs reaccreditation. Tim, thank you so much for all you've done for Vanderbilt, and congratulations.
Okay.
And our final award today is Vanderbilt's top research and faculty honor, the Earl Sutherland Prize for Achievement in Research. The award is bestowed on a faculty member who's garnered significant critical recognition nationally or internationally. Some refer to this prize as Vanderbilt's Nobel Prize. Well, the past recipients of the Earl Sutherland Prize for Achievement in Research who've joined us today, please stand. And their names are on the screen, and your program lists all the prior recipients. Joining this esteemed cohort this year, this award goes to W. Kip Bazuki. Kip is the University Distinguished Professor of Law, Economics, and Management, and co-founder and co-director of the PhD program in Law and Economics. As the author or editor behind more than 360 articles, over two dozen books, Kip is one of the most prominent and prolific economists in the world. His watershed research on the statistical evaluation of life has changed how scholars and government regulators approach benefits. Understandably, he has earned countless accolades and key positions, including his current post as the president-elect of the Southern Economics Association. Much like his previous publications, Kip's latest book, Pricing Lives, Guidepost for a Safer Society, shows how innovations in social science can radically inform policy and public affairs, therefore changing lives for the better. We are tremendously proud of your achievements. Congratulations, Kip. So as we wrap up and transition to this next phase of the Senate, I want to offer my heartfelt congratulations to all of this year's winners. And I'm going to turn the podium over to John McClain, who is going to take over. Thank you. Well, thank you.
So after move-in day, I'm always excited, full of hope and opportunity for the next year ahead. Being a chemist, what that means is I tend to vibrate at a higher frequency. And I see many of the chemists that are out there. So good afternoon. I'm John McClain. I am the serving as the chair of your faculty senate. On behalf of myself and Holly Allgood, here in the front row, we'd like to welcome you and really appreciate your engagement over the year ahead. We'd also like to thank past Vice Chair Jeremy Wilson, who's led us through today's program. Now, today represents one of the two faculty assemblies that we have each year. In the spring and the fall, and these are the pinnacle opportunities for us to come together in a unified way. The fall event is particularly important because it's a way to gather and reflect and chart our course for the upcoming year. The Faculty Senate is an essential component of Vanderbilt's model of shared governance, wherein key decisions about our university are made collectively by the 60 senators that represent all of the schools and colleges of this great university. Before I dive into some of our current priorities for the year, I'd like to take a moment to introduce you to the Executive Committee of the Faculty Senate. So in addition to myself and Holly Allgood, the officers are Chair-elect Catherine McTammany, Vice-Chair-elect Ben Harris, past Chair Vicki Green, and past Vice-Chair Jeremy Wilson. I'd also like to take a moment to thank Debbie Hayes once again, and you've heard her name come up several times. But she plays a very key role as the administrative manager for the Faculty Senate in being able to facilitate the work that we do every day. So every 4 years, the Faculty Senate undergoes what we call reapportionment, a process through which we reassess the breakdown of your representation from all of the various schools and colleges. Regular reapportionment ensures that you are represented equitably across the colleges and schools on the Faculty Senate. The 2019-20 year represents a year of reapportionment, and in many ways, this milestone is a reminder that we are all in this together, and that only by giving a fair voice to every facet are we really able to come together as a community to do the best that we can. The Faculty Senate will continue to work together to represent Vanderbilt's faculty, to engage a variety of stakeholders, to connect with university leadership, to discuss important matters, and to strengthen our trans-institutional ties across schools, departments, and areas of focus. Our theme for this year is civility and community, a topic that is arguably more important now than ever. And it's no coincidence that this topic covers a lot of ground. At first, the theme probably makes you think of people in this room, the civility and community you have built with your colleagues, and with every day you help students and solve problems. But it also refers to our relationship to society and our society's relationship to history. But more on that in just one moment, because I want to invite all of you to tell you how you can engage with your community as well. We can all embrace this theme by attending our Faculty Senate meetings. All faculty members are encouraged to attend these events, beginning with our next meeting, which will be on September 12th at 4:10 p.m. in room 140 of the School of Nursing's First Hall. I also want to thank Dean Linda Norman and the School of Nursing for providing us a space to gather in their beautifully renovated new building. At these meetings, we want to jump into issues that matter to all of us as faculty members. Topics such as how national policy affects our capability of teaching and performing research. These meetings are a great way for all of us to reinforce the ties of faculty. I hope you will join these conversations as they continue to shape our faculty community. We're also pursuing ways to highlight more members of a broader community in these meetings, and in particular to reinforce our ties and bonds and synergies between faculty and staff. One approach is through partnering with the Division of Communications to incorporate I Am Vanderbilt profiles at the beginning of each Senate meeting. As many of you know, these profiles spotlight a member of Vanderbilt's staff and the important contributions that they make to our community. This would drive home the significance of key figures around campus, and perhaps most importantly, celebrate the sheer breadth of people who help us do what we do every day. The Faculty Senate meetings are an opportune place for us to recognize them as they make our academic, teaching, and scholarly pursuits possible. Last year, Vicki Green and the Executive Committee made great strides surrounding the 2018-2019 academic year theme, Communication. Accomplishments included jump-starting a presence for the Faculty Senate on Facebook and Twitter, and also creating an entirely new platform that is still going very strong called the Faculty Engaged Newsroom, where we present content developed especially with you in mind. The Faculty Engaged Newsroom addresses faculty-submitted input and concerns. Since we last gathered for the Spring Faculty Assembly, some recent topics in the newsroom have included the future of childcare at Vanderbilt, given the strong demand by the university's faculty, staff, graduate, and professional students. This topic was addressed head-on by Kathleen Siebel, the executive director of the Vanderbilt Child and Family Center. An explanation of Vanderbilt's endowment and how it has performed over the last decade was personally addressed by Anders Hall, Vice Chancellor for Investments and Chief Investment Officer. These posts are a great opportunity for key leaders and administrators to address faculty questions, ultimately speaking to the why particular decisions have been made for the betterment of us all. Interim Chancellor Wente talked earlier about her guiding principles of trust, transparency, and teamwork. I think the Faculty Senate portal is a great example of how we engage in that guiding principle of transparency. We would like to take a moment to thank Vice Chancellors Brett Sweet, Eric Kopstein, and John Lutz, among many others on campus. Last year, we began meeting with our vice chancellors in what we term the breakfast meeting. It occurs at 7 in the morning for the early risers. And the topics that we discuss come directly from the Senate portal. That is, the comments and the questions that you as faculty present to us, that is effectively our agenda items. So the portal is a place where you can ask your direct questions with Vanderbilt's top leaders. If you submit your questions or concerns through the portal, expect to see that topic addressed through the Faculty Engaged Newsroom or in Faculty Senate meetings. I would like to say a few words about our Chancellor search process, a topic that will be discussed and covered in a special listening session tomorrow. This is hosted by the Chancellor Search Advisory Committee and the Chair of the Board of Trust, Bruce Evans, and the Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, John Geer. The session specifically for faculty will take place from 12 to 1 p.m. in Surratt Cinema. For anyone who would like to hear more about the status of the process, I highly encourage you to attend. And on behalf of the Faculty Senate, I would really like to thank the Board of Trust for all they've done to facilitate this search. And I'd like to thank them also for making the process so transparent, civil, and inclusive. If you haven't already, I urge you to visit the Chancellor Search website and complete the 5-question form. Hundreds of members of the Vanderbilt community have already done so, and the engagement is providing essential feedback on the search process and will help set the stage for the trajectory of our next chancellor. The themes of civility and community are also vital on a wider scale. Our society is more divided than ever, with higher education and its greater purpose under constant scrutiny. And yet there is one thing that continues to bring us together: our combined belief in the future. We are all here because we believe the power of research and discovery will make a difference. We must also apply our scholarship resources and innovation toward our own communities beyond Vanderbilt to change our city, to change our state, and to change our nation. Someone who we all consider a champion on this topic is Chancellor Emeritus Zepos. During his time as our chancellor, he not only improved Vanderbilt's caliber and impact, he also advocated for the importance of higher education as an American life force. We're grateful to him for all that he's done within our classrooms and so far beyond. Susan Wente, our interim chancellor, has been a driving force behind Vanderbilt's incredible trajectory. As we heard from her earlier, she has a keen understanding of where we've been and the trajectory that we are undertaking at the present. And we are very grateful to have you serve in that role as our interim chancellor. From the Senate, I would say that the state of our leadership is really extraordinary. We have a renewed focus on civility and community, and we have great strides underway by our committees, staff, and fellow colleagues. We're very optimistic about the year ahead. So in closing, this is your Faculty Senate, and I encourage you all to get involved. Get in touch with your senator. Now, if you don't know who this is, you can go to vanderbilt.edu/Faculty Senate, and we have a directory which will show you who can help you with the concerns that you might have. And again, by all means, please come to a Faculty Senate meeting. They are quite engaging. It's a great place to hear comments from our interim chancellor and to participate in important discussions. Again, our next meeting is September 12th, 4:10, room 140 in the School of Nursing, First Hall. Now, in the meantime, you can follow us on Facebook and Twitter. You can post your questions through the Faculty Senate portal and find the responses on the Faculty Engage newsroom. And I would also, once again, encourage you to attend the listening session tomorrow from 12 to 1 in Surratt Cinema on the Chancellor search. The more faculty members who get involved and the more means by which you get involved, the more effective we can all be, all of us. Thank you for being here.
Thank you so much, John. We are thrilled to have Susana Herculano-Huzel as our featured faculty presenter today. She is, according to her faculty page, Associate Professor of Psychology, Associate Director for Communications at the Vanderbilt Brain Institute, and a Chancellor's Public Voices Fellow. She is also, according to YouTube, the woman who turns brains into soup. The opening line in the preface of her 2016 book, The Human Advantage, says simply, "Humans are awesome." And she's here today to elaborate on that with her presentation, A New Narrative of the Human Story. Please welcome Susana Herculano-Huzel.
Good afternoon to all, and thank you for being here. I'm honored and thrilled to have been invited to speak to you in this faculty assembly. And I think you'd also like to know, so we get that out of the way, reception is exactly 12 minutes away. So you've just heard I'm Vanderbilt's brain soup lady. I do turn brains into soup, not to eat, but because that's the way I figured out I could count cells and understand what brains are made of, how many neurons, how many glial cells, how much vasculature. What I'm interested in understanding is brain diversity. As you see illustrated here, what is the extent of diversity, how it comes about, what are the constraints of diversity, if any, and what difference does it make if a brain is tiny or huge? When I first became interested in these questions, the common assumption was that all brains were made the same way, just smaller or larger versions of the same basic layout. And if that were the case, then a larger brain should always have more neurons than a smaller brain. And that's something we care about because neurons are the basic information processing units of brains. So the more neurons you find in a brain, the more capable that brain should be. And the largest brain around should also be the most capable. Of course, we think of ourselves as that most capable of all species, so we would love to be that species with the largest brain. You can already expect I'm going to tell you we're not. The elephant brain, for instance, is 3 times as large as the human brain. It's the size of my whole forearm. And yet, we are the ones who gather in schools and universities and dedicate our time to understanding ourselves and the world and even elephants. If they have bigger brains, then how come we study them instead of them studying us? That paradox is one of the many reasons why we have come to accept the view that there must be something special about humans. Other brains may be bigger, but the human brain must have somehow become better, extraordinarily, literally out of the ordinary. That is the notion behind the prevailing narrative of human evolution, the story of how our species came to be. If we became extraordinary, it must be because we were positively selected for something. According to one standard narrative, for instance, we humans were selected for delayed maturity in evolution, and today we have a much longer childhood than a mammal of our body mass should have, which is about 3 years. So we are that red dot on the graph, and that supposedly allows the brain more time to develop and become complex. Alternatively, or additionally, we supposedly were selected for extraordinarily long lives, much longer again than a mammal of our body mass should live, which is about 20 to 30 years. And that led to the idea that the evolution of grandmothers was a crucial step in human evolution. However that happened, humans must have been selected for. There must have been something extra that made humans special, extraordinary, including something that changed the human brain. For instance, our brain is not the biggest, but it is about 7 times bigger than it should be for a mammal with a body the size of ours. And it also became extraordinarily large for the body that we have, extraordinarily fast in just 2 million years, while all other primates remained behind. Not only the human brain as a whole is larger than it should be, its cerebral cortex is also considered to have become especially enlarged. That is particularly significant because the cerebral cortex is this part of the brain that sits on top of the other parts of the brain that actually have to do with taking care of the body and moving the body. The cerebral cortex gets a copy, like an email carbon copy, of every single message that goes on between the other parts of the brain and the body. The cerebral cortex also has these incredibly rich internal connections amongst its parts, which give it the possibility of making associations across the various things that happen to the body and then modifying behavior by acting on the rest of the brain. So it's thanks to the cerebral cortex and these new associations that it can create that behavior becomes flexible, which I've come to consider as my one-word operational definition of intelligence. Intelligent behavior is behavior that is not simply dictated by stimuli in the present, but it's flexible. It's behavior that can become more and more complex as it learns from experience and becomes adaptive as it uses those experiences to make predictions. So with the cortex, we gain a past and we gain a future. We also gain a window into other individuals' minds now that we have the means to use our own insights to infer their beliefs and intentions. We can become considerate of others as that mental space-time window now extends to predict how others will be impacted by our actions. And we can even associate with others and start building a body of culture, of knowledge, of know-how that we can then keep alive by passing it on to the next generation. Enter brain soup. By counting cells that compose the brain of different species of mammals and birds, and these here are just a small sample of the dozens of species that my collaborators and I have analyzed in the last 15 years, we found that although we indeed don't have the largest cerebral cortex, we do have the most neurons in the cerebral cortex of any species. Even whales, according to our estimates, only have about as many neurons as a macaw or elephant in the cortex. And what's more important, it turns out that we are that species with the most cortical neurons without ever having become outliers, but simply because our brain is built like any other primate brain, primates that we are, with neurons that become more numerous without ever becoming bigger, which is what neurons do in other mammalian brains. We are that species with the most cortical neurons simply because we are the one primate species that came to afford the most neurons, and that is courtesy of a very early cheat invented by our ancestors, the various and increasingly complex ways of processing food before it enters your mouth, also known as cooking. which lets you get more energy in less time and more calories from the same food, and became so fundamental for our lives, so integral to how we live, that we can now even take it for granted. What do all these cortical neurons get us? More flexibility and cognitive capabilities, certainly starting with the very process of cooking. But I discovered just recently that more cortical neurons also come naturally with two even more consequential things: longer time to reach sexual maturity and longer life. Once you have numbers of cortical neurons to compare and you can ignore body size just to see how things play out, you realize that the more cortical neurons that a warm-blooded species has, the longer it takes to reach sexual maturity and the longer it lives after reproducing. And you see on those graphs that humans are no different from the expected for a generic warm-blooded vertebrate with our number of cortical neurons. Now, let me just point out that all these species that you see here, short or long-lived, with just a few or a lot of cortical neurons, they're all alive and well, so none of them, not even humans, can be said to be better or worse, more or less adapted or fit than any other species. They're just different. Not more, not less. I published this study just a few months ago, so it's still too early to tell whether the number of neurons in the cerebral cortex is just a really good proxy for life history or actually a cause of a slower life. While I do want to investigate next how more cortical neurons might actually directly slow down development and prolong life, the fact for now is that these are such amazingly good correlations that however they happen, we can expect that gaining more cortical neurons is something that comes with prolonged childhood and increased longevity. So when we put all this together, the story of our species becomes one of not just more cortical neurons afforded by more energy made available by growing cognitive capabilities and skills, but also one where at the same time, children remain children for longer and longer times, soaking up information as they coexist with adults that also live longer and longer times. So the story of our species is a story of increased coexistence across generations and longer overlap between young and old. Why do I think this is so tremendously important? Because as we age and experience the world and solve problems that we shape our brain and turn these biological capabilities into actual abilities and have the opportunity to develop them to the point that they become codified into something that we call technology, any process, method, system, object, or even knowledge that helps us solve problems and do that faster. And now that we have gained free time, we can move on to the next, more interesting, more complex problem. This is a point beautifully made by the sadly late Hans Rosling, a Swedish physician and statistician, in my favorite TED Talk ever. I strongly encourage you to watch it. It's just 9 minutes long. And in this talk, he explains why he thinks that the washing machine is the most transformative piece of modern technology, because it allowed his mother to stop spending all this time doing laundry every day and gave her free time that she could now dedicate to learning English, to go into the library, to reading stories to young Hans, and then transmit her culture to him. And there you have it. The more cortical neurons a species has, the more its biological capabilities, but also the more hours it spends awake, which is a whole other story I didn't tell you about. And this gives it more opportunity to use those capabilities and turn them into abilities. With even more cortical neurons, life begins expanding significantly to the point where those learned abilities start getting organized and systematized as technologies that can be now taught across individuals. Even more cortical neurons, and you get even more time to learn and develop those technologies to a point now where they save you a more and more significant amount of time, so you have a really significant amount of free time available in your hands. And once you have enough cortical neurons in a species brain like ours, that life is slow enough and long enough that you start having years of generational overlap, you have the stage set for something much more than simple reinventing the wheel from scratch in every generation. You now have cultural transmission, which again is not a human exclusivity, but we do it exquisitely because if on the one hand, our largest number of cortical neurons that give us unequaled capabilities make living very costly, on the other, the naturally slow development and the naturally long life that come with it afford us the time and opportunity to hone those capabilities into abilities. And so the human story as of 200,000 years ago now actually becomes a story of progress with every new generation. Not biological progress, not evolution, not in this time scale, but a story of progress of know how and know what. At this point, we become a species with so much to learn and to teach with each new generation that we have realized the absolute necessity of having schools and universities to house and provide the means to the people who curate that knowledge, who create new know-how and know-what, who keep it alive by organizing it, interpreting it, and transmitting it to the new generations. And that's you. Teachers, professors, mentors, instructors, you are what makes modern humanity so much more than just beefed up primate biology and keeps it that way, which is why I'm particularly honored to be here and to honor you with what I propose to be a new, simpler, natural, but no less important narrative of the story of how we and you came to be. We are fortunate to be that regular primate with the most cortical neurons, but what really makes us part of modern humanity is that what we choose to do with all those neurons and all the time and opportunities that they afford us to make more of ourselves. Thank you so much for your attention.
And with that, our program is ended. We want to thank you again for being here, and we hope to see you back on April 2nd for our spring faculty assembly. In the meantime, we invite you all to the reception. Thank you so much.